It's January, and I'm sure a lot of you are thinking about writing your will. And one of the most frequent questions I get is, how important is it to write a will? Do you really need one? What happens if you die without a will? Well, that really depends on what you own. If the purpose of a probate is to make sure that the debts of your estate are paid and that property is transferred. So if you're talking about transferring, for instance, you know, a diamond ring, well, there's no paperwork that's involved with that. You hand the diamond ring to someone, they accept it, it's transferred. And so as long as your heirs aren't fighting with it, do you really need to go through probate or have a will to say what happens to that diamond ring? With other property, it gets more complex. If you have stocks, for instance, in a brokerage account, you might have a beneficiary designation on that account. And if you do have a beneficiary designation, then that beneficiary designation is going to control, and that property is going to pass. Those stocks are going to pass to the beneficiary, regardless of whether you have a will or not. And the same rule applies for retirement benefits like a 401k or an IRA. If you have a beneficiary designation, that is going to control what happens to that property. When it comes to real estate, things get a lot more tricky. Now, just a few years ago, the Texas legislature did authorize what is referred to as a transfer on death deed. And this is where you can sign a deed during your lifetime that is going to indicate what happens to your property after you pass away. And the big benefit to doing it as a transfer on death deed is it doesn't prohibit you from selling the property. You can revoke it. It's not effective until death. You can still borrow against it. It really takes care of almost all of the problems that we had with early transfer of real estate beforehand. You still get to maintain if you're over 65. You still have your over 65 exemption. That's not been messed with. And it works really, really well. The big problem is that since it wasn't authorized until September of 2015, very few people have executed transfer on death deeds. So in most cases, if you don't have a will, your property, your real estate, is not going to be transferred on your death. Now, there's a common misperception in Texas that community property is all going to belong to the surviving spouse. And that isn't necessarily true. And for instance, real estate, you're still going to need to have some mechanism to transfer ownership of that real estate from the person who passed away, even into their spouse's name. 20, 30 years ago, we used to all the time do an affidavit of heirship. This would be a document that people would sign saying, hey, these people were, you know, married, or these were the children, and this is who the heirs should be. And we would file that, and that would effectuate transfer of title. But what we're seeing more and more is that title companies are not willing to insure title without a probate proceeding, without letters of testamentary, or without some finding from the court on who the heirs are. And some title companies are still willing to. It really depends on how valuable is the property. But the more time that goes by, especially since we now have the ability to do a transfer on death deed, and there's an easy way to transfer title, you see more and more title companies are really starting to insist on a probate proceeding. So if you have a will, Texas probate is very straightforward and very simple. But if you don't have a will, it gets a lot more complicated. So the first thing you need to know is that if you pass away without a will, there has to be essentially a separate probate proceeding brought called a proceeding to determine heirship. And this is a finding from the court on who your legal heirs are. And what that means is, let's say that you pass away and you have a surviving spouse. In most cases, statistically, the man passes away first, so I'll just say the woman's surviving. She's got to go to court to prove that she was your wife, and she's got to prove who your children are or what your other heirs are. And so to do that, she files the proceeding to determine heirship. And the court is going to appoint an attorney ad litem, and that is an attorney to represent your unknown heirs. And it's their job to verify that everything that your wife is telling the court about you is accurate. And sometimes it's very straightforward. They just want to talk to a few witnesses. They show up in court. Sometimes it gets in a little more depth. The other thing is you've got to bring witnesses. Your wife would need to bring two witnesses to the courtroom with her to testify as to your marriage, the fact that you weren't divorced, other times that you'd been married, children that you had, and all those other facts that go along with establishing who your heirs are. Now, once the proceeding to determine heirship is over, you still have the question of, well, what happens to the property? And again, I get from a lot of people this presumption that obviously it's all going to go to the surviving spouse. And that just isn't necessarily true. In fact, if there are children from another marriage, so for instance, let's say you have children with one wife and then you remarry and you have children with the second wife. Your new wife, when you pass away, will inherit only her own half of the community property. She's not going to get any of your share of the community property. That is all going to go evenly to your children. And with most of the people I've spoken with, that's not what they want. Well, if that's not what you want, it is extremely important that you write a will and make sure that what you want is known to everybody. Now, even if there aren't children from a prior marriage, if you have inherited real estate, for instance, well, that won't all go to your spouse either. Some of that is going to pass down to your children. And it gets kind of complicated. I don't want to go into a lot of detail on that. But my purpose is just to say, if you own real estate, if you have, for instance, accounts that you don't have beneficiary designations on, it's really important that you write a will. And a lot of times you hear people saying, everybody needs a will. Well, definitely there are people that pass away that have a will and we don't end up needing to probate the will. But I would still encourage you to definitely draft one. And the reason is because you can't be sure right now when you pass away if a will would be needed or not. I typically use two examples. You know, you get a lottery ticket and you're so thrilled and you know, you have a heart attack and you die. Well, you just died a millionaire, right? And you couldn't anticipate that that was going to happen, but now, hey, you really, really need a will. And it's too late at that point to decide that you need to run out and write one. And the other example is, you know, you're hit by a Exxon truck and you linger around for a few months and then you pass away. Well, once again, you've passed away a very wealthy person, and it wasn't something that you could really anticipate happening. In my practice, I have been writing wills and doing probate in the state of Texas for 25 years, and I have seen many, many examples where people had no idea that death was imminent, and they didn't write wills, and it turned out that they were needed very badly. And they could have saved their loved ones a great deal of cost and confusion and sometimes pain and arguments with their family if they had taken the time to write a will in advance. So I would encourage you, if you don't have one, see an attorney, write a will, take care of your affairs. It is one of the most meaningful gifts that you can do for your loved one, is to have your affairs in order. If you have any questions, feel free to post them in the comments below. This is a regular program. I'd be happy to address them. All of the questions that I answer are based on Texas law. I am a licensed attorney in the state of Texas, board certified in family law, not licensed anywhere else. So if you live in any other state, you can disregard everything that I've said, but post a question and I hope to hear from you. Thanks.